ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्यं नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जायामुदीरहे नष्टप्रायेष्वभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवतसेवया। भगवतीरुत्तमश्लोके भक्तिरभवती नैष्ठिके कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकीनन्दनाय नन्दगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। श्रीमद्भागवतम कैंटो 10 चैप्टर 50 टेक्स्ट 56। यद् यद् भगवता दातम् अधिपत्यम् स्वसिद्धये सर्वं प्रत्यार्पायम् आशूर आरहो भूमिगते नृप। यद्यद् भागवता दातम् आधिपत्यं स्वसिद्धये सर्वं सर्वं प्रत्यार्पायम् असुर अराव भूमिगते नृप। यद्यद् भागवता दातम् आधिपत्यं स्वसिद्धये सर्वं प्रत्यार्पायम् असुर हरौ भूमिगते नृप। यद्यद् भागवता दातम् आधिपत्य स्वसिद्धये सर्वं प्रत्यार्पयम् आसुर अराव भूमिगते नृप। मत जीस यत यत वॉट एवर भगवता by the Supreme Lord, datam, given, adhipatyam, delegated power of control, sva, their own, siddhaye, for facilitating the exercise of authority. Sarvam, all. Pratyarpayam asuhu. They offered back. Harau, to Krishna. Bhumi, to the earth. Gate, come. Nripa, O King Parikshit. Translation: the Supreme Lord, having come to the earth, O King, these demigods now offered him whatever powers of control he had previously delegated to them for the exercise of their particular authority. Text 57. After transporting all his subjects to the new city by the power of his mystic Yoga Maya, Lord Krishna consulted with Lord Balram, who had remained in Mathura to protect it. Then, wearing a garland of lotuses but bearing no weapons, Lord Krishna went out of Mathura by its main gate. Purport: Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti quotes the following verse from Sri Padma Purana, Uttarakhand, to describe how Lord Krishna transferred the citizens from Dwarka to Mathura. In the middle of the night, as the citizens of Mathura slept, Lord Janardhan suddenly removed them from that city and placed them in Dwarka. When the men awoke, they were all amazed to find themselves, their children, and their wives sitting inside palaces made of gold. Thus ends the purport of the humble servants of His Divine Grace, Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, to the 10th canto, 50th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled Krishna Establishes the City of Dwarka. Om Ajnanati Mirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prestaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Vancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namine Gauratvishe Namaha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Rishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Jayasi Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivas Adi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Hare Krishna. So we are in the last two verses of this chapter entitled Krishna Establishes Dwarka. And in this last two verses, we are seeing exactly what happened, that Krishna has established this city in the sea, which is in current time in Gujarat. So there has been a good connection between Uttar Pradesh and Gujarat, which is even now there. So Krishna goes to Gujarat and establishes the Dwarka city there. So Krishna is going to be known from now on also as Dwarkadish. He is until this time in Bhagavatam, there was absolutely no mention of Krishna as Dwarkadish, because there was no Dwarka in the picture. Still now Krishna spent more than 10 years, little over 10 years in Vrindavan. Then he spends the remaining few years in Mathura. And then when he sees this constant attacks of Jarasandh, and then now we have Kalyavan coming in the picture, he decides that his devotees, the Mathura Vasis, should be, they need a place where they can peacefully reside, the Yadavas. So Krishna is slowly but surely going physically away from Vrindavan. He was in Vrindavan, then he went little away to Mathura, not so far. We also know right now, half an hour, 45 minutes, we are in Vrindavan from Mathura. So he was not that far. But as things change, in Mathura, he was a student. He did his education. There was no education in Vrindavan. There was nothing like a Gurukul where he was studying. It was simply fun, enjoyment, fun and frolic and enjoyment. That's what Vrindavan life was for Krishna. And that's what Vrindavan is all about. Fun, enjoyment, rasa, exchange of rasa. But when Krishna came to Mathura, there was something formal in his life. Vrindavan was completely informal. But there was something formal which happened in Mathura. He had to go to a teacher, study. There was some relationship with having some formality between his parents, Devaki and Vasudev. There was some responsibility. And then he goes on to take this further responsibility of becoming Dwarkadish, the ruler of the new city Dwarka. So what is responsibility? If you analyze, Krishna takes more and more responsibility as his life, as we are studying his life. It's such a wonderful occasion that we have. The facility to study the life and character of Lord Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, as it is happening, verse by verse, in Bhagavatam. Very great facility. So here Krishna, in this verse, exactly right in this verse, is shifting from Mathura, he's leaving Mathura, he has already created this city. He is becoming more responsible. Of course, Krishna is always responsible. We cannot say he is becoming more responsible. But in the pastime that he is enacting in Bhoma Vrindavan, we can see the life of Vrindavan was full of, if I'm allowed to use the word, irresponsibility. Stealing, throwing butter, breaking pots, life of irresponsibility in one sense. But as the time goes by, the life of irresponsibility gets converted to a life of some responsibility, and then further it becomes a life of more responsibility. So responsibility is nothing but our ability to rightly respond to the changes in life. Very nice word, responsibility. What is responsibility? It's our ability. What ability to do what? To respond. Respond to what? It's the ability to respond to the changes in life. And the one thing that does not change is change. There is constant change in our life. We are all going through so many changes. Every second things are changing. The situation in our life is changing. So this change is brought about by the powerful energy of Krishna in the form of time. Kalosmi. Krishna says, time I am. And he says, destroyer of all. Mrityu sarva harascham. In the form of death, I take away everything. And death is nothing but the passage of time. What is death? I mean, in a nice way, if you say you are dying, then you feel a little scared, because I'm dying. But time is passing, is as bad, but it doesn't sound so bad. That's why you use the word time pass. Time pass is the greatest loss you can ever do to your life, to pass your time, because time is nothing but moments taking you closer to death. I was discussing with some people, and I think we mentioned it also earlier in our discussions, that what is the most horrific and horror music, dangerous music, dangerous sounding music? I mean, you know, we see in movies, in horror movies, there's typical music which starts, and we know that something dangerous is going to happen, right? You know, when the squeaking sound of the door comes, you say something is going to happen now, and then the music starts, the typical horror music sound, right? And then we know, and then there's, but this is all horror sounds, and everybody is catching their seat and waiting to see what's going to, the monster is going to come, or some ghost is going to come, or something is going to happen. But the simplest sound which we don't reckon, which is actually the most horrific sound, is the ticking of the watch. If somebody wants to really show horror without really giving some special effects of this sound, simply shows the ticking of a watch with complete silence in the background. You know, of course, we can't have silence right now, but if you wanted to experiment, you can experiment at 1 o'clock in the morning tomorrow. When you just have the sound of the clock, and you know, for 15 seconds to hear, it is not so horrific. But you hear that for more than 5 seconds, you start going insane. It's that horrific. Because time is that powerful. And when you hear the sound of that clock ticking, it is that much more horrific, because you know, you realize that time is going by. But what does time do? Time takes away all the wonderful relationships that we have with our loved ones. Either the loved ones are not there, or we are separated by distance because from the loved ones. The wonderful time of relationship with lovely places. We have relationships. People talk about the time they spend in the villages. I met a person who, you know, recently he's been staying in the Silicon Valley, America, for the last 25 years. He's a big man. Made millions for himself, you know, by this IT boom. And I was talking to him, I said, my dear friend, what is the most, what are the thing that you remember the most in your life? Is it the IIT degree that you got? Or the IIM, he's the IIT IIM, and then he did his PhD and many things like that. I said, what was the most memorable, as the discussion went by, I just asked this question. He said, the most memorable time I had, he said, is in my small village when I was milking the cows that we had in our house. I said, are you serious? You are not saying this because I'm a Krishna devotee, right? He's not a devotee. I said, don't try to impress me, just make me feel good. I said, no, seriously, this is the best time I had in my life, to milk the cows in my village. Because my village was so beautiful. Such a beautiful village I lived in. Scenically beautiful, pure, clean, and everything else. So, but time, he said, has separated me, and I'm staying in the Silicon Valley, I'm staying in, you know, in San Jose, and all this modern, you know, city life, but I miss that life in the village. So time takes away the relationship which we shared with loved ones, the places that we loved, those are beautiful places. In due course, we are separated from them. For devotees, it is a time that we spend in Vrindavan. The time that we spend in Shridham, Mayapur, many of us who are not able to stay there, we miss those places. And then also the wonderful time of innocent childhood. Time takes it away. The childhood is a very innocent thing. You know, just childhood by itself is an innocent period of our life. But as the time goes by, the innocence goes away, and what comes is cruel adolescence. The cruel teenage, the cruel hormonal changes in this body, which makes us lose all of our innocence, and then we start becoming very, very complicated. This is time. It's a time which takes away everything slowly but surely. Hmm? So that's why it is said that past is always good. We always feel that the past is good. That's why this phrase is there, the good old days. Not only in devotee terminology. Everybody talks about this phrase. Oh, it was such a good old days. It was such nice. The school life. A moment you really want to strike a sort of a good conversation with somebody, ask him about his childhood. My dear friend, how was your childhood? I said, oh. And he will start going into the down the memory lanes, as they call. And they start appreciating the past. So the point that we are talking about is the past is good, and but the problem is there is change, and change always happens. There has never been a time where there is no change. And the change is so powerful that even Krishna goes through that change. He changes. He gives up his life in Vrindavan, the life of fun, the life of milking the cows, as our friend was saying, Krishna was milking the cows. And then now slowly he's going to Dwarka, which is a beautiful, and the explanation, I mean, we have read the description of Dwarka. 16,108 palaces, all of gold, and everything else. Aristocracy. Dwarkadish means aristocracy. Dwarka means aristocracy. Krishna is going to go from Vrindavan, the simplicity of Vrindavan, to somewhat modern living in Mathura, and to high-tech living in Dwarka. That's what Krishna is doing. So Krishna is the changes. But we always say that, oh, I'm missing the good old days. And many times there's this unfortunate, I mean, it's a fictitious concept which we hear in the science fiction movies of the time machine. I remember seeing a science fiction movie. There's a time machine, and then there's something was called flux capacitor, I remember clearly. And they do something and you go back in time. And then you're gone 30, 40 years behind time, and then, or maybe more. But there's nothing like a time machine. It's a science fiction. Fiction word comes from fictitious. Fictitious means that doesn't really exist. So it's a fiction, it doesn't really exist. So there's nothing like a time machine. But the wonderful thing is that Krishna has given a time machine right in the creation, right in our own system. What is this time machine? The memories that he has given all of us as a gift. The memories that we have. That's the time machine. Through the memories, we can relive the past. If we put life into them. Simple memories, you know, we can just think of them and then there's no life and we just feel sad about it. But we can relive the memories. We can put life into those memories. And experience those memories, and that's actually the, in one sense, a time machine going back in time and experiencing the beautiful past that we have. Rather than complaining about losing the past, rather than complaining that, oh, I've lost the good things in life. Many of us miss, you know, the association that we had with devotees, miss the simple relationship that we had, but now things are becoming more and more, you know, organized. You know, earlier yatras, I'm just talking about yatra, and the first yatra that I attended, I'm talking about 1988, and we talk about yatras, I mean, yatra is a big thing. 6 months back, everything starts management, right? We start booking the rooms. The first yatra that I attended with the yatra leader who's taking the yatra for so many years, he was there. And the first yatra was two ambassador cars. That was the first yatra. You're talking about 60, 70, 80, 90 buses, 140 buses. It was two ambassador cars, and we miss that good old days where there were two ambassador cars. And even in that yatra, two ambassador cars, one car broke down. So all of us were in one car, sitting on each other's lap. And you have your guru sitting on your lap, and you feel nice about it. Oh, so nice it was, you know, where I was with my guru so close. He was sitting on my lap, and he was hugging me and all this. That's nice and that's wonderful and you can relish it. That was what something I got and many of us got. But you can just be cribbing about it. Oh, now that days will never come. You know, now he's the author of big, big books and he meets big, big people. And you know, where is this two ambassador cards? And there's no way to even, you know, talk to. I mean, many things you can talk of a respective special. Everybody's getting busy. Everybody's getting more organized in one sense. And you can crib. And what will you attain out of the of cribbing? Just moroseness, despondency. That's all that you will get. But Krishna has given these beautiful memories. Rather than getting despondent with life, and that's the way Krishna, and I was analyzing that the whole murti, the whole archa vigraha of Lord Jagannath is nothing but Krishna's memories of Vrindavan. And that gave rise to the whole form of Lord Jagannath. Krishna remembering Vrindavan in Dwarka. So it's such a powerful process that there is a whole archa vigraha murti, one of the most prominent murtis in our Gaudiya Sampradaya, the murti which was the Pranadhana murti of Lord Chaitanya, which was nothing but formed when Krishna was reminiscing his time in Vrindavan. Not that he was cribbing, oh, why the hell I am in... Of course, he had that situation where he said, what am I doing in Dwarka? You know, I'm missing the gopis. That's all there. But he was reminiscing, but he still did his duties. And doing duties in Dwarka were not easy. In the next few chapters, you will see the story of the Shamantaka jewel. In the next two or three chapters, I think. Shamantaka jewel. And what is the Shamantaka jewel story? It's all about how Krishna was misunderstood. And Krishna had to clear the doubts that people had on his character because he was a leader. As a leader, people can't doubt. Caesar should be above suspicion, as they say. So he had to clear all the doubts and he had to go and fetch the Shamantaka jewel. Of course, in the bargain, he got married to two princesses. He had two queens. Or three. Two. Jambavati and Satyabhama. So, but Krishna went through misunderstanding, and you can say, well, there were good old days where everything was so nice, nobody misunderstood, everybody was talking very nice to each other. But there will be transactional issues when we start becoming bigger and becoming so-called more organized. There will be transactional issues and there will be misunderstandings. There would be, as I said, transactional misunderstandings would always be there because there are more transactions. More transactions means more possibility of misunderstanding. And Krishna went through that. Can you imagine that Krishna was doubted that you are a jewel thief? Krishna was told, you are a thief. You know, stealing butter is something innocent. And they accused Krishna in a very innocent way that Krishna, you are makhan chor. There was absolutely no negativity when Brijbasi called Krishna makhan chor. Absolutely no negativity. But when Krishna was told that you are the jewel thief, you are stealing the Shamantaka jewel, there was powerful negativity. And his name was getting defamed. And he had to really make sure that the people were proved wrong. That's why he did the whole endeavor to go there, fight with Jamavan, you know, get the jewel from Jamavan and prove that, see, I didn't, and give it back to Prasena, and sorry, to Satrajit, right? Satrajit. So Krishna went through those phases of transactional misunderstanding also. And we also go through that. But we have to go through that because responsibility is more important than sentimental attachment to the object of our love. One thing is we love the object and we were sentimentally attached and we want to be physically close to that object, which is good. Which is to some extent definitely pure love. But the higher love is to take responsibility on behalf of Guru and Krishna, and the responsibility will take you physically much away from the object of your love. But you do that because it is in taking the responsibility that you get the mercy. You don't get mercy just like that. When do you get responsibility? When people trust you. Right? When people trust you, they give you responsibility. The guru is equal to all. Srila Prabhupada is Jagat Guru, is guru of everybody. But still, he gave special services to those people whom he trusted. He didn't give service to everybody. There are few people whom he trusted and he gave them special service. Tamalakrishna Maharaj, go and get the land of Mayapur. Because he trusted Tamalakrishna Maharaj. He knew that this man can do it. Giriraj Swami, manage the Bombay temple and get this land for me. The six couples go to London because Prabhupada trusted them. It's not that everybody got this opportunity. So similarly, Guru is equal to all. But if we want to take responsibility, we need to be trustworthy. And when we become trustworthy, that's when we get special mercy. And we all talk about, right, special mercy. We all want special mercy because without the mercy, there's absolutely no way to make progress in Krishna consciousness. You cannot do it on your own. We need mercy. We are desperately dependent upon the mercy of Guru and Krishna. And mercy comes when you take responsibility. Mercy doesn't come when you just are sentimentally talking about sentimental things and not do anything, sitting and doing nothing. You're going to be doing that for the rest of your life and not get a single drop of mercy. You might be sounding very sweet. You might sound very, very, very soft. But that's not where you get, how you get the mercy. Mercy means to take responsibility, and responsibility is sometimes very, very hard. Apparently very cruel. Apparently taking you away from the object of your love. But the object of your love, if you are really responsibly doing that service, you are never away. And that's why Srila Prabhupada, a classical example, he said that I never ever experienced a single moment of separation from my Guru. And where was Prabhupada? 10,000 miles away, and his Guru was not even present, he was not on this planet. But there was not a single moment of separation from my Guru. Prabhupada said that. And that's a deep lesson to learn. Prabhupada didn't sit on, you know, just sentimentally sit in Bagh Bazaar or sit in Vrindavan and he said, you know, just missing my Guru, and I'll chant extra rounds, 64 rounds, 192 rounds. Prabhupada was a man of action. I'm not saying chanting more is bad. But the point is, responsibility is very, very important in our life. And we see our leaders of ISKCON, how much more and more responsibility they are taking, even though their age is progressing. The time factor is affecting them, but still more and more responsibility to serve their Guru. So this is a very, very important lesson that we learn, you know, from Bhagavatam, that how Krishna does this transition from Mathura to Dwarka, teaches us a very, very important lesson. The lesson of responsibility in life. Spiritual life is not about only sentiments. Spiritual life is all about responsible sentiments. The sentiments of responsibility. When we begin Krishna consciousness, it's all about sentiments. Prabhu, enjoy. You can eat your way back to Godhead. Right? We heard all these things. You just come, eat prasad, and you can eat your way back to Godhead. And after 5 years, cook the prasad first and then eat it. Hey, you never told this to me. Just read the books for hours, no problem. And then after 5 years, distribute the books first. What is the score? What is the commitment? You never told this to me. But that's what response Krishna consciousness is all about. Enjoying. But enjoyment really comes when you start taking more and more responsibility. And in one sense, responsibility may not give you the enjoyment. But who says that we came here for enjoyment? We came here for Krishna's enjoyment. We came here for Guru's enjoyment, because we are not the enjoyers after all. If Krishna, when he comes to the material world, also goes through the misunderstanding and suffering apparently, who are we to say that we want to enjoy? It would be absolutely stupid on our part to say that. There's no misunderstanding in the spiritual world. Nobody misunderstands Krishna. No, nobody does that. Right? The misunderstanding only happens in the material world, and Krishna goes through that. So this just a transition is a wonderful lesson. Transition of Krishna from Mathura to Dwarka and becoming Dwarkadish, managing 16,108 wives, managing 6,108 palaces. It involves huge amount of management, my dear friends, right? When just having a small goshala and a small house in Vrindavan is not so much management. Of course, he had 9 lakh cows, and it was simple management. Just go up to Ter Kadamba tree and play the flute, and all the cows would come running. It was nice management. Krishna can manage it. But just see Krishna, don't see Krishna as God in this case. Just see Krishna as a wonderful person, as a person who is carrying out his duties as the time is demanding for him to do. If you see him as God, then everything appears to be very simple. But see him as a person who is carrying out his duties, because he is doing so. Because at some point of time, he went to his guru's ashram. Krishna doesn't need a guru. He's Jagat Guru. But why did he go to a guru, Shantipani Muni, and did his studies? Because he was doing the needful, what the time demanded. And when the parents said, you should go to the Gurukul, he went to the Gurukul. So Krishna was living like a person doing the needful as per the time, place and circumstance. So here Krishna, as a time, place and circumstance, is establishing Dwarka, a huge city, managing that city, getting married to so many wives. And as we see, there'll be beautiful episodes of Krishna in Dwarka, wonderful leelas of Krishna in Dwarka as Dwarkadish. So he's taking responsibility. But that responsibility is in no way making him even a step away from Vrindavan. In his heart, he's always meditating upon Vrindavan. He's already meditating upon the beautiful, lovely past. So that's what we learn from Krishna. Yes, we have a nice past, the good old days, everything was nice. When we came, we all have our share of mercy that we got. Special mercy. All of us, we ask the story, every one of us will share that, yes, I got this special mercy. But now somehow it is gone. Narad Muni also had his special mercy. He got darshan of Krishna. And then he's gone. He was searching for it throughout his life. So we all, right from our original guru, Narad Muni, Lord Brahma, and everybody down right now, all of us, all have our share of special mercy that we cherish in our hearts. And many of us miss it. But what's the use of missing it and cribbing about it? Just relish it in your heart. Remember it. Remember means be a member of that memory. Be part of it. And you will experience a wonderful, effect of reliving those things, the way Krishna teaches us by his own life. The second thing that we learn, it's in this first verse, it's explained that the demigods, it is said, the Supreme Lord having come to the earth, O King, these demigods now offered him whatever powers of control he had previously delegated to them for exercise of their particular authorities. Very, very interesting, extremely interesting verse. Very deep words. It shows that how do we really deal with the responsibility that Krishna gives to us. Because with responsibility comes authority. And when we have authority, the natural outcome of authority is what? Power and control. That's what the demigods. It's beautiful verse here. That Krishna gave them the power of control in order to exercise their authority over their specific responsibility. Isn't a beautiful understanding? That Krishna gave that, and then now the demigods are giving back what Krishna had given them back to Krishna. Indra is building the Sudharma palace for him, and the hall, and Varuna is doing something, and other demigods are giving back to Krishna what Krishna had given them back. What Krishna had given them originally, they're putting it back in Krishna's service. So we all must understand that whatever we have in Krishna consciousness, whatever responsibility that we take in Krishna consciousness, whatever ability we have in our Krishna consciousness, as we live our life in Krishna consciousness, Krishna says, I am the ability in man. Very, very clear statement. Cannot be misunderstood. Very clearly mentioned by Krishna that I am the ability in man. I'm the strength of the strong, and I'm the ability in man. But with those abilities, with the ability to take responsibility, comes power and control. And the problem is, when we have power and control, power corrupts. And absolute power corrupts absolutely. And none of us have absolute power. Because a nice word used here is, that he had previously delegated to them for exercise of their particular authority. So Krishna has always given us a particular authority. A water department head has no authority in the power department. They will respect him. Oh sir, welcome sir. You are a head of water department. But if he says, do this, sir, sorry, we don't listen to you. You have no authority here. Because a particular authority is a particular specific authority that Krishna has given us. and that authority will not work anywhere else. The only person whose authority will work everywhere is only Krishna. Krishna has given us very limited authority, you know, limited access, as we say, you know, people in networking, you know, there are different people who get limited access, you know, because, you know, they might visit some wrong site, so they have limited access. They can access only, you know, the emails. And some people are little more advanced or so-called, they will have access to, you know, some more websites. And some people who are dependable, they can go to YouTube and they have access to all these things, hoping that they will not use it in the wrong way, right? So that access is based on, Krishna has given us specific access, right? So similarly, all of us, because the responsibility that we take on behalf of Guru and Krishna, we get certain power, certain control, but it is very specific to our service. But the problem is, we try to lord it over. Ishwar aham, aham bhogi. But Krishna says, bhoktaram yagyatapasam sarvaloka maheshwaram. That only I am sarvaloka maheshwaram. But when we get some power, we start thinking that I am also sarvaloka maheshwaram. If not sarvaloka maheshwaram, but at least this loka maheshwaram. So we have this problem. So there was a beautiful seminar many, many years back that was given by His Grace Govind Prabhu and Shyamanand Prabhu. And he said there are four major obstacles of leadership. Now when I say leadership, it is, we are not talking about leadership the way the material world understands. We are talking about leadership means the way people who are taking responsibility. So even a mother is a leader. Even a head cook is, everybody is a leader. Basically, who takes responsibility is a leader. But there are obstacles. There's obstacle to become papi when we become leaders. Now, I'll explain to you the word papi. P-A-P-I. It's an acronym. What does papi mean? Papi means sinful. Papi hai. Right? We say papi. It's a Hindi word for those who don't understand Hindi. Papi. Papi means P standing for power. A standing for association, which is bad association. P again standing for passion. And I standing for independence. Power, association, bad association, passion, and independence. When you become a leader, you have these four major obstacles. Power. You can use the power in Krishna's service and get wonderful things done. Or you can use your power for your own self-aggrandizement, for your own pleasure, and fall further down into the pool of material energy. So power is dangerous. Because power gives you control. I mean, of course, there's no more time to explain. But yes, power is one of the serious difficulties that we have. And we have seen so many people, so many leaders who have seriously fallen down because they didn't use the power the way they were supposed to use. And they get severe reactions to that. Association. Now, association is good, Prabhu. What is wrong with association? But we're talking about the right type of association. Too much association with juniors and no association with equals and seniors will be disastrous for our spiritual life. And that's what the leaders are exposed to. So many yes men around them. Yes, Prabhu. Yes, Prabhu. Yes, I'll do this. They don't see faults because they see you as Prabhu. You are a great man because you are senior, 20 years old, chanting devotee. You are sleeping in a chanting. And they will sing, oh, you are meditating. Or equal will say, arey, utna bhai, kya so raha hai? Only equal will tell you this. If you overeat, the junior will say, Prabhuji ko itna achha laga prasad. Very, he is just enjoying. I said, control your senses, man. Equal will tell you that. But we are laughing. But it is serious, serious, serious trouble because the way situation happens when you become a leader, the time, the way the Maya organizes things around you, will have to really go out of your way to find equal association. Otherwise, you will be abundantly surrounded by junior association and they will corrupt you. You may know it here, but you have to know it here. Just intellectual knowledge is not enough. Yes, yes, I need equalization. Yes, I need equalization. That's of no use. If you're not convinced in your heart about it, and that's the danger of association. And when you're in front of your seniors, which you get, by his purity, all the good things will come out of you. Not by your purity. And you say, well, I am quite good. I don't think of anything bad. I'm quite an advanced person. See, when I'm with my senior, with my guru, I just think of dynamic ways of service, and I think of Vrindavan and ways to serve Vrindavan. So I'm so nice. But that's not your, it is the power of what you call induction. When you are with induction of, what is it, science word? Induction. That when you are with somebody, when you are rubbing the magnet against the iron, you rub it for a long time, that iron becomes a magnet. Why? Because the power of induction. You are rubbing. So whatever good you have, of course it could be because of your bhakti, but majority of the good that you have is just induced goodness coming from a senior devotee, coming from a spiritual master, coming from a very wonderful serious sadhaka. You can never think it is my own things. That's a danger. And then you have the passion, the third danger. I'm sorry, yeah, association, passion. A passion to do the way I want to do things, my way or the highway. What is it? Shape up or ship out? the passion that you shape up better, you shape up the way I want, or ship out. Get off the way. Because passion to achieve things, passion to love things and use people is quite prominent. It could be prominent in leaders. And that's a danger. That's a major obstacle. And the third is independence. Independence to do the way you want, because you are a senior person, you have certain independence. If you don't use the independence in the right way, it could be detrimental for spiritual life. So here the demigods are showing, there are many examples in Bhagavatam where they show by doing the wrong things and we learn from them what not to do. But here, for a change, they're showing what a wonderful exemplary behavior. Yes, Krishna is created Dwarka, and here is Krishna like the Ganges. Let me offer the water of the Ganges back to the Ganges with my own mantras, with my own love put into it. Hobe prema pradipe aroti tomar. Beautiful song by Bhakti Thakur. I said, Aarti, what is, you just use the cotton which is given by Krishna, the fire is given by Krishna. This was a purport that I heard from one of the leaders here. But what does aarti mean? Is just that you are putting your love. Otherwise, everything is Krishna, you're putting offering back to Krishna. But what you are doing, which is not Krishna's, which is your love. And you have the you have the choice of using it for Krishna or not using it for Krishna. That's why when you do something for Krishna, Krishna becomes very grateful. Isn't it surprising that Krishna becomes grateful to his devotees when you do something for him? Surprising, right? Why should Krishna be grateful? Because Krishna said you are supposed to do it. But no, Krishna has given us the independence. And when Krishna sees that he is using the independence in the right way, that's why he becomes grateful. I said, this is a wonderful devotee. I'm so happy you use the independence in the right way. But wrongly using the independence is dangerous. So demigods are giving it back to Krishna. That yes, Krishna, you have given us these powers. You have made me Indra, you have made me Varuna, you have made me Agni, you have made me everything. Your powers, you have given us. Now we want to give it back to you for your service. And that's the purpose of all the powers that we have in our life. What a beautiful example the demigods are teaching by their example, by their own behavior. That using everything in Krishna's service and nowhere else. And Krishna's service and service of Krishna's creation. For the service of God, and for the upliftment of mankind. That is where the power should be used. And then, if we use this our life in a nice way, if we have lived a life which is Krishna-centric life, then the current present will be the future past. So in order not to have nightmares of your past, let's have a proper present. When you are thinking about the past, the childhood was innocent, which is good. All of us were children. I mean, many of us came. Nice childhood, innocent childhood. But let's not make our present life a mess, and let alone trying to be controlling and power hungry. Because when you do sit and make the audit of your life, at the end of your life, let's not get nightmares. Let us get proper, sweet memories. And those sweet memories is something which we are creating now. That's very, very important. And then as this, the second verse, we'll end in 2 minutes. The second verse is talking about, you know, the Mathuravasis were sleeping, and Krishna is such a loving, considerate, sensitive God. Just recently, a few months back, you know, I shifted my house. First time in my life. I stayed in my previous house for 40 years. It was my house, and I never shifted in my life. Then I shifted, and it was a nightmare. You know, to shift a small two-bedroom hall house was a nightmare, to pack the boxes and unpack them, and oh my God, and all of us know, you know, for those who are doing yatra, you know, those who pack the, I mean, many of us do the kitchen packing, to pack the truck and to go and unpack it and again pack it, it's a whole endeavor. It is nightmare to go in, and Krishna, and it's the word used after transporting, Krishna uses. So transport is the most horrible thing. You know, all of us know how terrible getting transported is. Any means of transport, whether it is road or by ship or by flight, it is a horrible, transporting horrible. But see the amazing power of Krishna. That the Mathuravasis are sleeping. They slept in the night in Mathura. You know, and you know, we used to have this particular serial coming. I will not name the serial, it won't be right. But you know, where they were sort of energized, and some people were energized, and they would just go to some other place. You know, there was a serial coming, energized. So here, Krishna energized them, and suddenly from Mathura, they get up in the morning and said, oh, with their children, with everything, no transportation, no, what are they called? Clearing and forwarding agents. Not dealing, it is such a headache to deal with them. Logistic agents. It's terrible to transport anything. And half the time, you lose things in transit. You know, even one of the very senior delegates of Indian, one of the top officers of India, she went to Australia by Air India flight. And, you know, luckily she was a cultured lady. She wears only saris. And she went and she reached a place and her bags didn't come. And there were no saris available in that country because nobody wears saris, Australia. Even our bags of a big, government official gets lost by our great national carrier. transportation is a crazy thing. But yes, imagine the situation here. You know, Krishna says, no trouble to the Mathura. It's not that Krishna says, oh, pack up your bags, pack everything that you have. Now we are going to go in, you know, we are going to get shifted to Dwarka. They were sleeping. Krishna didn't even disturb their sleep. It's just beautiful transition from Mathura to Dwarka. And palatial. They were shocked. It's written. Lord Krishna, what is it? Our Vishwachakra Thakur says, they were amazed to find themselves, their children, their wives sitting inside palaces made of gold. Suddenly from Mathura, which was quite aristocratic, but not as aristocratic as Dwarka, they get up. Just imagine you're sitting on you're sitting in this floor of a temple, and suddenly you find yourself energized and you get up in some fancied land. That's the power of Krishna. And we think it happened to the Mathuravasis. So fortunate they are. But it will happen to all of us also. I was just analyzing. What is death for a devotee? Death for a devotee, as Bhakti Dev Maharaj explained, is the perfect escape. You close your eyes in the material world. There will be one day for those who have been loyal to Srila Prabhupada, those who have been loyal to Krishna's teachings, those who have been honest in their dealings, those who have been very straightforward in their relationships. There will be a day where we will close our eyes in the material world, and when we opened our eyes next, we will see the palace of the spiritual world. So that is the greatness of Krishna Bhakti. That is the greatness of the Bhagavad Dharma. That's why Don't stop chanting. Keep on chanting. Don't stop reading. Keep on reading. Don't stop hearing. Keep on serving. Because one day we will, hopefully, we have hope. Not hope on our endeavor, but hope on Krishna's mercy. That when we do close our eyes, and there are people, it has happened to them. They close the eyes and they open the eyes as the Dwarka was, as Mathura was. They open the eyes and they were in the palatial, environment of Dwarka. Let us all pray that if we are faithful to Prabhupada, we will achieve that particular destination. When we do open our eyes next, we will be there. So this is the perfect escape plan that Krishna is teaching us through this process of Shravanam Kirtanam. So let us live our life responsibility with life of honesty. Because only when we have lived our life of responsibility and honesty, can we make a perfect escape. Otherwise, we'll be again punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam. Again in the cycle of birth and death, we cannot escape this. When we get up, again we'll be in the horrid place. We'll be in a more dingy place. The next time we die and again we get up, again more worse place. That's not what we want. So let us all be faithful to Prabhupada's mission. And let us chant Hare Krishna, and that is what we can learn from this beautiful last two verses of this chapter. And next we are going to be getting on the deliverance of Muchukunda, the next chapter. Very interesting story. How Krishna without a weapon, that's why it is written here. Krishna left Mathura without a weapon. That's the power of Krishna. He gets this barbaric guy, he comes with all the, and Krishna is sus. I mean, he doesn't need any weapons. He just leaves without a weapon, just with a lotus flower. And we'll see how, what happens. And how Krishna does things so wonderfully. The brilliance of Krishna. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Any questions, any comments, any corrections? Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki. Shri Rukmini Dwarkadish ki.